people. So Intel just announced their 9th generation processors, and while there are not that many surprises, I'm here to give you a quick rundown on what to expect when these new CPUs launch on October 19th. So of course we'll have a full review of it then, so stay tuned for that. But it's clear that Intel is trying to better compete with AMD, because to be honest with you, Ryzen 2nd generation and Threadripper 2 are so well positioned for both gaming and productivity and value that Intel has to almost like catch up. And it's interesting because AMD has been this underdog for so long, and now it is kind of the company to beat in terms of price to performance, and that's a good thing. More competition in the market, better innovation forward, and seeing how the two giants go head to head to deliver us better products. I would recommend you check out our 2700X review to better understand how far AMD has come in such a short time. And the 9th generation is Intel's way of hitting back, but as you'll see in the video, they still may have some way to go. But let's get into that after a message from our sponsor. The new Masterkeys MK750 keyboard comes with a comfortable magnetic wrist rest, beautiful RGB light bar on the perimeter, and per-key lighting control with a variety of Cherry MX switches and a bottom Type-C connection. Cooler Master doing it right. Check it out below. All right, so let's start with a quick recap of what these new CPUs have under the hood, and believe it or not, there isn't all that much new. So these new processors may be called 9th generation, but they still use Coffee Lake as their core architecture. That means a revised and highly optimized 14 nanometer manufacturing process and the continuance of Intel UHD 630 graphics. And for people who are hoping for a larger upgrade, we'll have to most likely wait till 2019. And supposedly the QuickSync video core, which is so important for video creators, you know, speed up render times in Adobe Premiere and, you know, Final Cut and other NLEs, that has not been updated. So aside from having higher clock speeds, higher core count and thread count on these processors, the quick sync function has not been updated, and therefore don't expect improvement that we've already been getting with 8700K and the likes. All right, so let's observe what the entire stack looks like. Starting at the top is the i9-9900K, which has 8 cores, 16 threads, and the clock speeds that can hit up to 5 gigahertz. That 5 gigahertz is only when 2 cores are engaged, and considering most games can utilize like up to 2 and 4 threads, this is a pretty big deal, of course, if you can afford this processor. And I feel like the conversation will definitely derail into the 9900K versus AMD's Ryzen 2700X, which has 8 cores, 16 threads, so they're on par on that spec. But of course, clock speeds definitely favor Intel side, but it's almost 2x the price versus 2700X, which is around $300. So value is definitely leading towards AMD. And actually, the question of pricing will probably come up a lot for the 9900K, because the 1000 unit price is $488, but that is your best case scenario, because the pre-orders begin and it's around $525 to $580. And just to give you a pricing perspective, the 8700K, when that launched, it took 3 months for the price to stabilize around the MSRP of $359. So just be aware of the pricing that may be, you know, higher for the 9900K and the new 9th generation platform leading up to Christmas, and hopefully, you know, stabilize in the new year. As always, please wait for full reviews to come out to make your purchasing decision. Don't pre-order just yet. And one interesting tidbit that came up while I was editing this video is that Stephen Walton from Hardware Unboxed went through the Principal Technologies report on how they benchmarked the 8700K, the 9900K, and the Ryzen 2700X, and he uncovered a little interesting tidbit about the memory timings for the AMD system and how they were not set properly, therefore kind of crippling intentionally the AMD side to make Intel appear much faster, obviously. So take any information that is given by Intel, and until we have the full reviews about the percentage improvement of these new 9th gen processor versus previous versus Ryzen, with a giant grain of salt. And yeah, again, wait for full reviews. Okay, back to our handy chart, you can see that Intel is choosing an odd path for the i7-9700K. Instead of offering 12 threads like on the 8700K, this processor has hyper-threading disabled. So it's only an 8-core, 8-thread part which is odd. You associate i7 processors with hyper-threading, but not in this case. It also gets knocked down to 12 megabytes of L3 cache, which is odd since usually Coffee Lake processors have 2 megabytes of cache dedicated per core. It actually costs more than 8700K, and let's not forget the 2700X is going to be in the equation here as well at around $300. So it'll be interesting how the 9700K will like fit inside the market and exactly what places will occupy, because on paper and specifications, it's really nothing to get excited about. And personally, I'm really excited for the i5-9600K. I think it'll be an amazing processor for games. It doesn't cost a fortune. 6 threads, you know, 6 cores, overclockable, perfect. But I will say that, you know, I've been using the 8600K as my primary video production CPU. It's only a 6-core, 6-thread part, and it's been performing fantastically well at 5 gigahertz. So I have no doubt that the 9700K will be an absolute beast of performer. It's just, it doesn't make sense kind of when the 8700K exists, and that's also a fantastic CPU that is slightly cheaper. But then again, AMD offers some really good value gaming processors too. The 2600, it costs a lot less. Now, there's been a lot of debate on what type of interface Intel has used on their high-end processors between the IHS and the core, which is why the whole deleting spectrum has kind of risen in popularity, but that is supposed to change with 9th-gen processors. And so now they will solder the IHS directly to the core, the soldering TIM is what they call it, to improve temperatures, overclock headroom, general performance, and hopefully that claim is going to be, you know, tested and verified. Now, it also looks like Intel is taking a page from AMD's packaging, no longer just a boring, you know, cardboard box, although environmentally friendly. Now it's going to have this kind of cool acrylic packaging with angular sections. Definitely will look really cool on the retail shelves, but we're not sure if this is like for consumers or for reviewers. We will see. Hopefully it's also recyclable. Now, as for the motherboard side of things, not much has changed. And while every company will be launching their Z390 products, many have announced, like MSI, ASUS, that their Z370 motherboards will be totally compatible with 9th-generation CPUs. But then again, there are some interesting additions to the Z390 platform that need to be taken into account. First of all, the Z390 chipset finally makes jump to native USB 3.1 Gen 2 support, so chipset PCIe lanes won't be wasted on secondary controllers anymore. There are up to 4 Gen 2 ports that motherboard manufacturers can enable or disable depending on the price point of the board. And another more forward-looking addition is the Intel's SNVO interface, which promises wireless AC and other next-generation wireless connectivity. And if you remember our Whiskey Lake mobile processors, you can check out over here. We were wondering when they'll finally migrate into the desktop space, and now they have. But the thing is, it doesn't really add any functionality. It just increases your bandwidth. And so what have motherboard manufacturers chosen to do with the slight revision of the Z390 chipset? Let's take a look at ASRock Z390 Phantom Gaming 9 as an example. This is ASRock's highest end Z390 board of time being. It will retail for $270. And don't worry, because there'll be plenty more of ASRock Z390 motherboards that come with a ton of features, but this one is a cut above. It looks great, and I have to say, it's impressive to see how far ASRock have come with their designs. Let's start with a PCIe slot layout, since for Z390 boards, it is pretty unique, since ASRock didn't need to use those chipset PCIe lanes for third-party USB 3.1 Gen 2 controllers. They were able to add a third function 4-lane PCIe 3.0 slot, which would work perfect for storage or network add-in cards. Just take note that multi-card GPU setups will operate at a dual X8 format, though according to statistics, there aren't that many people who use SLI or Crossfire anyway. This board also has 4 USB 3.1 Gen 2 connections on the backplate, one of which is a Type-C port. Unfortunately, there aren't any front panel Gen 2 pins on the board itself, which is pretty disappointing since many cases have that Gen 2 connection on the I/O. Okay, so that covers the motherboard space a little bit, but also Intel announced their new high-end revised desktop X series CPUs. I'm really not going to comment much about these since that's a topic for another video, but these are revised 9th-gen HEDT processors, but let's just say they're basically clock speed bumps of the previous generation. They still use X299 platform, and pricing hasn't moved one bit from the Skylake E CPUs. And we actually have to wonder if these are 9th-generation processors after all, since they use much older architecture versus the 9900K. The Be Quiet Dark Bass Pro 900 Revision 2 is here with a modern I/O for your Type-C accessories and Qi charging gadgets. The new hub is good for 8 fans and RGB strips, plus the interior is incredibly modular for airflow, water cooling, inverted systems, and now with the power supply shroud. Check out the V2 down below. All right, so there you have it. Intel's 9th generation processors explained. I'm most excited about the 9900K, in particular its performance with Adobe applications, and especially because it has that Intel graphics, although it's not really updated, but it's an 8-core 16-thread monster with Intel graphics, which will totally, hopefully fly in Adobe Premiere. Compared to 8700K, two additional cores, that's amazing. But the 9600K, I'm excited for gaming applications, although I wonder what type of performance boost it will receive versus, you know, the 8600K, which is already a fantastic performer at 5 GHz. So let me know which processor you'd like us to compare the new 9th gen versus on the AMD side. Hopefully we'll try to deliver, and which of the entire stack are you most excited about? Let me know in the comments below. I'm Dmitry. Make sure to check out this other relevant content. And yeah, we'll see you in the next video.